going on, sports fans? Another great episode of Jersey Bullies hosted by yours truly, Erik Brezzo and Tyler Freed.
Hi, Dad.
All right. So basically, we're going to do a quick rundown of what happened since the last time. As usual, you had the Sixers. They're 6-1 right now. You have the Flyers getting ready for practice. You have the Phillies not really doing anything, but the Sixers have been looking pretty good.
Fucking Tobias Harris, man. Told you that man was going to pop up and look good under Coach Rivers. Oh. He is killing it.
Well, Eastern you couldn't look any worse. Of the week. You couldn't look any worse than what he was with Brett Brown. So,
I mean, I'm sure he could have gotten worse, but he's not. He's playing great. Joel Embiid's just, you know, double-double machine, obviously. He's killing it. Between him and Tobias and then Ben Simmons out there, how about that three-pointer on New Year's Eve? That
was Everyone's cool, waiting for it, man. Everyone's waiting.
What a way to go into the new year, and he probably still hasn't attempted one. So, yeah, I'm loving the Sixers. Sixers are looking great, top in the Eastern Conference, number one, ahead of everyone, even the likes of the Brooklyn Nets, who we play this week. I'm excited for that matchup, even though Kevin Durant is on COVID protocol, so he won't be in for that game.
Oh, really?
He's on COVID protocol, so he has to be out for at least 7 days.
Oh, I did not know that. Well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
What about Kyrie? Is he going to be there?
Kyrie should be there. The rest of their team should be there. I haven't heard anything new on Spencer Dinwiddie, so I don't know. I know he's out for extended time. I just don't know how long of a time for him. It's a winnable game. I mean, you stick Ben Simmons on Kyrie, and that's, you know,
that's yeah, he's, really. Ben's able to shut down basically anybody, so yeah. Majority of the time.
And, I mean, I understand Kyrie's Kyrie, and he's still going to get his points. I would assume he's still going to get, like, 21-ish, but, I mean, that's better than Kyrie going for 30.
Yeah.
It's going to be a hard 21.
Absolutely. But you got the freaking Flyers coming up next week. You know, that's freaking awesome. I'm excited about that.
Yeah, we're gonna dive deep into the Flyers next week. We're gonna do a preseason, basically not a recap, but a season review, like to see how the season's gonna go for next week.
Next Monday the 11th is, and then it'll be dropping on the 13th. Game day. Game day for the Flyers, dropping game day.
Game day. So get your podcast in for that and be ready.
Get your popcorn ready, as the great T.O. once said. All right. So that's a perfect transition. Go straight into the main topic. The good old Philadelphia Eagles. The dumpster fire that happened on Sunday in this past week. What the hell is going on?
They're just they wanted the sixth overall pick. That's all I could say. Everything was Howie Roseman, that wonderful person who's still employed by the Philadelphia Eagles.
Everyone was fine with them losing. No one cared about them losing. Everyone was on board. But
until they did it.
Yeah, well, no, it was because how they did it. That was the problem.
I was cool with it.
Huh?
I was cool with it.
No, you. There's no way, man.
Man.
The whole game, you're close. Like if it was like three touchdowns down and you put in Nate Sudfeld, I'm perfectly fine with it. But the fact that you were 3 points, you went for it on fourth down, which obviously he always does. So I write that off. I don't care. But the play calling after that was terrible. Like everything, there was no innovative Doug anymore. That. You've seen with Jalen Hurts the last couple games, but then you take him out going into the fourth quarter and you're like, holy shit, you truly are trying to lose this game. Make it a little less obvious, but you made it fully obvious when you put Sudfeld in and the dude was terrible. See, and you're only losing by three, man.
That's not trying to lose the game. I mean, Nate Sudfeld's been in the system for 4 years. He's got to be able to run it. He's got to be able to go out there and do it. I mean, if they really wanted to lose the game, they should have just started Carson Wentz from the start. We would have just been destroyed.
Oh, damn.
But bringing Nate Sudfeld in, I mean, he said it early in the week. There was a really good chance for Nate Sudfeld to get in that game. And, I mean, Jalen Hurts wasn't doing shit. I mean,
he has the
two rushing touchdowns, but That doesn't mean he was doing well in the game.
He has it down by three. You can't take him out and put in Sudfeld.
No, our defense had us down by three. That was what it was. The defense
two rushing touchdowns is 14.
The defense
points,
played outstanding. Man. Okay, come but on. The defense gave him field position, so Jalen Hurts could rush for 32 yards and throw for 60. I mean, that's fucking absurd. You should not be able to play three quarters and have that as your stat line, and you scored 14 points. That means your defense gave you good field position. So the defense kept us within 3 points. It wasn't our offense doing shit at all.
Dude, every single person out there is hating on the decision. You even have your own players that tried to confront him and go after him that he was being confronted on the sideline. They actually had security come over, and apparently this is all – no one knows. No one knows the truth. This is from Jeff McClain. But they had people holding him back, security. They had other players holding two defensive players back from going after Doug for basically changing everything. You want Sudfeld in, you start him at the half. That's what you do. You don't bring them in when you're down by three in the fourth quarter. It doesn't make sense. It's a blatant integrity issue. He is an asshole, and he needs to go.
Jalen Hurts had his opportunity to get us the lead with that fourth and go for it. So I mean, Jalen Hurts lost his opportunity. What that has nothing to do with.
Yeah,
Doug
fourth
Peterson.
And four, yeah. Yeah, it was a terrible pass by him. He basically sidearmed it. It was a shitty pass.
Exactly.
I completely agree. It was
wide
open. And
we benched him for Nate Sudfeld, so it's perfect.
Benched for Nate Sudfeld.
Listen,
oh my God.
I want to tell you right now, I feel bad for Doug Peterson and the scrutiny that he's getting for this. He is literally a fucking puppet for Jeffrey Lurie and Howie Roseman. He was told at the beginning of this week,
100%.
You're putting Nate Sudfeld in because there's no reason you'd even fucking dress him at this point. Unless you were told by your GM, hey, you're going to try to play this game. We want to see what he's got. Or, hey, we really want to see you just, you know, fucking completely tank this. So put Nate Sudfeld in there because we know he's not going to fucking do anything.
And that's what Miles Sanders said on the radio.
You lost your mic. You just muted your mic. I can't hear you.
Oh, you can't hear me?
I can hear you now. You're back. All right, we're going to have to find that in the audio. Anyway, 3, 2, 1, go. I can't hear you again. What are you doing?
Is it working?
Oh, yeah, it's working now.
I don't know what I'm doing. I'm not doing anything.
Don't know what you are or aren't doing.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, so even Miles Sanders came out on WIP today. And he said that nobody liked the decision to bench him. Like, he even came out and said it. Then you had Kayvon Wallace immediately after Miles Sanders went on the radio and said, if that ain't your mentality to win them all, then what are you playing for?
Listen, I understand players are going to be pissed off about this, but this was straight a front office move. Who has never been in an actual fucking football, NFL football game. I understand the players are going to be pissed off. And I completely agree with them being pissed off with the way they handled it. But Doug Peterson handled it the way he felt like he needed to save his job. I guarantee they said, if you don't blow this game, you're going to get fired. And Doug likes Philly, so he wants to stay here. I don't blame him for that. But I think that Howie Roseman should have been fired because of this decision. Like, I don't understand what the fuck Jeffrey Lurie is doing at this point. Jeffrey Lurie is just completely screwing our football team. He's
100%.
At this point, we are currently recording on a Tuesday, and we're past Black Monday. How did we not fire anyone? There was not a single firing that actually happened.
Well, there you could say there technically was. You had the scapegoat that is Jim Schwartz, and
that hasn't even been official yet. Like, that's not it. Jim Schwartz leaving isn't officially official yet.
True.
Because you know why? Because they haven't even fucking requested interviews for any of the defensive coordinators that are available. There are so many good defensive coordinators that are available currently, like your boy Gus Bradley used to want him as the head coach. You can bring him in as D coordinator now. That just interview him. If Schwartz is leaving, then you need to interview for the defense coordinator job. You need to start doing something. Like, they're doing absolutely nothing in Philadelphia fucking fashion. Doing what the Phillies are doing. Okay, let's just fucking, you know, kick rocks for a few weeks, and then we'll jump into it and we'll pick the last of maybe the people who want to come here. Like, it was so sad last season that when we started interviewing for the offense coordinator job, there was people denying our request because they just didn't want to. They didn't want to come join. No. They didn't want to deal with it
because of this right here, because of the freaking dumpster fire that is our organization. Nobody wants to work with Lori and Roseman.
I don't understand how Howie Roseman is still an employee of the Eagles. Like, I'll say it 1,000 times. I just don't understand it.
He's been an employee for 21 years. 21.
Draft's fucking terrible. He's put us in, like, do I think he'd get us out of this cap situation? Sure. He's already worked on it with Jeffries and the Jackson contract. He already reconstructed that. So basically, if we cut them by June 1st, we save $23 million in cap space from them. So wonderful. Great. And I'm sure he's going to find other people to do it with and it'll work out. But that we shouldn't be in this cap situation. If he was landing on good draft picks, we'd have a ton of rookies that we could just, you know, have out here playing instead of signing all these fucking terrible veteran draft or free agent signings.
Like, just, they had a conversation on January 4th. So they had the end of the season press conference. They rolled them both out. They rolled out both Roseman and Peterson as a united front. They were together, and basically Peterson had zero questions. It was all for Howie, and he said the same thing in back-to-back years. So last year he said that we don't have our head in the sand talking about DK Metcalf because we chose J.J. Arcega-Whiteside. We see how he's doing. We don't have our head in the sand, blah, 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 blah. And they asked him the same question. Justin Jefferson was on the board, and you chose Jalen Reagor over him. Why? Well, we don't have our head in the sand. We see what they're doing, blah, 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 blah. But we just had a bigger need for speed and this and that. When has Jalen showed the speed? The dude looks like he checks out almost every single game.
Absolutely.
When he's not injured anyway. He was injured for 6 weeks this year, but when he's in the game, he's not given like full speed every single time like Deshaun does. Deshaun's an idiot, and he did a front flip that ruined his season again. But, like, I don't understand it. Like, how can anybody be excited about seeing Reagor come back when the dude is, like, half checked out almost the whole entire game?
He's on Twitter by halftime and when he gets injured. Like, it's – I've been a defendant of Jalen Reagor because you can't compare him to Justin Jefferson. They're two different players. They're in two different systems. They're on two different teams that are doing two different things. So you can't really compare them because, I mean, honestly, Philadelphia, they don't value the receiver. Like, the last – I don't even know the last 1,000-yard receiver we had. Oh, wait, no, never mind. It was Jeremy Maclin in, like, 2014. That's the last 1,000-yard wide receiver. I mean, I know I believe Zach Ertz has gotten 1,000 yards before, but I mean, we don't value the wide receiver like that. And we need a wide receiver coach that knows how to coach wide receivers. We say it every year, and they change the wide receiver coach every freaking year. But they need to coach. I forget who was saying it. Someone was saying about the wide receivers. They basically just run routes. They don't know how to create the separation. Like, all they do is just run the route. They don't know how to extend the play. They don't know how to get, you know, away from the cornerback. So if you're just running a route, the cornerback's going to be able to read what route you're doing and just cover you. Like, that's all you have to do, and that's why they get destroyed.
And look at Aguilar. That's a perfect example of a dude that couldn't do anything in our system, and he goes out to Las Vegas and had one hell of a year.
Under
a different coach. Like, that's what you're talking about, is the coaching.
Aguilar is a different story because what he's doing in Oakland, he did it here. He just would always he just end up dropping the ball, like, from when he was getting it. Like, he, I don't know, I think he just couldn't handle the mentality of being in Philadelphia. Like, he was one person that just could not handle being in Philadelphia whatsoever, because the pressure was off of him in 2017. He had a phenomenal year, but then the next year, you know, he had a rough start to the season. The pressure got back on him and he couldn't recover from that. And then, you know, that was 2018, 2019. He had another shitty year and then faked an injury to stay out for the rest of the year because he was too busy being a crybaby. I don't care. Fuck Aguilar. He's not a good example. I think he's just in a different system with different priorities going on. That's really what it is.
Well, it's basically – but my example is showing that coaching helps with everything. Like, you look around the league and you see – like Jordan Hicks out in Arizona. He was so injury prone here. He hasn't been injured out in Arizona. So how's that all of a sudden change? Coaching, trainers.
Someone said that they think that Doug Peterson's practices are the reasons why we have so many injuries here.
Like, not intense enough or too intense?
I don't know which way they meant it, because I don't really know what his practices are like. But they were just saying, like, I forget, it was someone on Twitter. They were talking about it. It was like a little link I was reading. And it was just they thought that Doug Peterson's practices, like, whatever's going on, is the reason for all the injuries. Because, well,
probably not intense enough, because you have majority of the veterans, they don't even practice. You know, when Jason Peters was actually alive, he wasn't practicing. Brandon Graham wasn't practicing. Fletcher Cox, like, the list was on and on about who was practicing. And majority of the time, I know you really can't do padded practice, but they weren't doing really any padded practice. And I'm sure this year was a whole different world having COVID around. So you probably couldn't even do more shit than what you normally could.
And yeah, that's true.
So I can only imagine, like, you're having virtual practices, you're doing this and that. Like, so the amount of padded practices you probably have this year completely went down. So I could definitely see that being true, that the more injuries is because Doug's a soft coach. Like, everyone likes him. Everyone respect, or I don't even know if they respect him anymore, especially after this last game. So
me personally, there needed to be a change. Like, there had to be some change. We can't go into next year with – and honestly, I feel like we're going to go into next year with – I mean, obviously, we're probably – you can already see we're going in same GM, same coach, whatever. We can't change that at this point. But we really might go into next year with Carson Wentz, Jalen Hurts, still as both of our quarterbacks, the same issue of who's the quarterback, who's not the quarterback. How are we going to do this? And it's not going to fix Carson Wentz by doing that, because Carson Wentz still has to deal with, oh, okay, well, if I struggle a little bit, Jalen Hurts is fucking going to be right up my ass and come out and play. And that's an issue, because Carson needs the confidence in the coaching staff and the GM if you want to keep him.
And himself. Okay. He doesn't have confidence in himself right now.
If you don't – so even if he doesn't win the starting job, and then you put Jalen Hurts in, he wins a starting job, he's the starting quarterback. What? How do you have a $30 million backup? Like, that's what – it's just going to make zero sense to even attempt doing any of this. Like, it's just – they're just going to run it back on a shitty year. You don't run it back when you just had a 4-11 in 1 year. No. You don't do that. You run it back if you have, like, an 11 and fucking 4 in 1 year. Not – so aggravating.
Well, what the reports, what many people are reporting is they're going to run it back with the GM and coach, because this was a weird year. They keep on every press conference that they've had, they mention COVID in some aspect. They use that as a crutch. It's unbelievable, because you have it around the league. It hasn't affected Andy Reid out in Kansas City, which our show talked about last week. He's the only one that is going to, if he actually gets the NFC Championship game, he's going to be the only coach in NFL history to host three straight AFC and NFC championship games. He did it with the Eagles, obviously, and he may do it with Kansas City this year. The only coach in NFL history. But, like, they're not blaming COVID. Nobody is. Just Doug Peterson and Howie Roseman.
It's they want to find a crutch and they want to use it. It's just astonishing to me.
It's the same thing with the Phillies. COVID took away $120 million, so we can't go out and spend everything. Dude, you're worth billions of dollars. You can afford to spend money on JT. You can afford to spend money on get Didi Gregorius back. You can afford to do this. Like, I don't understand all these owners say they're crying poor and crying all this stuff about COVID and this, COVID that. Like, it's absolutely insane.
I understand it slightly when you're crying poor, because I understand as much as they are, you know, millionaires, but to being a millionaire or a billionaire or whatever, when you're losing multiple $1 million, it sounds, you know, that would be insane for someone like me or you to lose. That's like us losing $1,000. Like, that's a lot of money for to just lose off of, you know, or I guess it would be like a year, it'd be like 10 grand. That's a lot of money to lose to live. I mean, I understand why they're crying it. Like, I get it's a financial burden on everyone, but when you don't have to be a baby about it.
You I don't say, get
hey,
it.
Look.
I think it's ridiculous. No respect for them.
I could just see why. I don't agree with it. But I understand it at the same time. Understand why they have the quote unquote money issues and restrictions, because they don't know. And like, we don't know when we're getting back to normalcy. So this could be a second season where they lose that money, and that's even more revenue lost by teams and such. Just like you saw today, reports saying that the NHL is naming their divisions after sponsorships just to get some more money.
Yep.
I mean, it's a huge hit, and it's not cheap to make these sports teams play. It's definitely not cheap, and I can't imagine how much money it's costing for all these COVID tests.
Oh yeah, absolutely, especially on a daily basis. Like, the NCAA March Madness is going to be going into a bubble in Indianapolis, so they're going to be doing the COVID testing on a daily basis, but they're going to be doing a bubble as well. But yeah, with the NHL, they have the Scotia Bank, the North Division, Honda West Division, Discover Central Division, and Mass Mutual East Division. it's so weird. The divisions always change every year anyway, though. But now that it actually has a sponsor to it is just weird and interesting. And like you said earlier, that they may end up going to what the NBA and soccer do, which basically you have the sponsor's name on the jersey and shit like that. So it's definitely going that way because of the COVID world that we're in. And like you said, you don't know how long this is going to be, but I just don't agree with them crying poor and this and that. Like, they're going to be able to make their money hand over fist once when this is all done. So everyone's like,
I agree with that, but when's it going to be done? So like, they don't know when. So it's hard to make big financial commitments when you don't know when you can or can't. So that's what I understand. Okay, so imagine COVID does, you know, it affects, you know, baseball and attendance for the next, we'll just say for 2 years. So you're paying JT Realmuto, what, probably close to 25, 30, 30 million a year. I believe that's like roughly what his 1 year is going to be.
Yeah.
You're paying that for 2 years without getting much, if any, revenue back for it. It's a hard take. And I'm number one person who wants the JT Realmuto signed, and I don't want any excuses for it. But I understand the financial part behind it too.
You have the TV deal though, like with all the sports. They're getting that money. It's not like they're losing money. Like, they may be losing the revenue, but they have the TV deal. They have the sponsors deals for everything else. Like, baseball has it all over their walls and the seats, everything. There's sponsors everywhere. Same thing with obviously every sport. But so to come back and complain about all the money they lost, I just don't agree. But Anyway, let's get off that side topic because that will take forever just to talk about COVID again. We don't want to go back to our first episode. But so go back to the Eagles. I don't know how Doug, because everything seems to be blaming Doug. That's what everyone, even though everyone knows it's Howie, but you know that Howie is like Jeff Lurie's left arm. He's not going to chop it off. He's staying forever. There's no way that he'll ever go. So basically now everyone is centering their attention on Doug because they want him to go, especially with what happened on Sunday. They're blaming him, even though everyone knows it's Howie's fault. So, but I don't know how Doug can survive this. They're like, if this goes on for days, weeks, months, you have 9 months until the training camp again. Like, you may forget it in 9 months, obviously, but in a couple weeks, you know, people are still talking about this. This is a national report.
This is one of them storylines that obviously, you know, we're going to hear about it next year when we face the Giants, because the Giants are a bunch of little crybabies who went 6-10 and they want to cry because we quote unquote tanked the season. So they didn't make the playoffs because of that. I just think that
Joe Judge come out and basically slam us.
Yeah. And I can't wait for the Eagles to just smack up the Giants next year. Just to put it to them. Be like, yeah, let's see what happens when we actually play.
Did you see Michael Irvin's comments?
No, I didn't see Michael Irvin's comments. I really don't care about ex-Cowboys.
Well, he was on, I don't know if it was TV or if it was a radio show, but I just saw a report. Basically, he said that all the Giants players need to shut the hell up. Like, you had 16 games in order to get a winning record to go into the playoffs, and you didn't do it. So you're gonna cry because the Eagles basically tanked the fourth quarter, but you didn't show up all year. So yeah. How about you shut the hell up and move on?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, they can't keep bitching about it because they didn't do their job. All Evan Engram had to do is catch the ball against us, and then they were in the playoffs. Like, that's all they had to do. But they didn't do it, and they fucked up.
Yep.
So I don't want to hear about that. And other than us facing the Giants next year, I really don't think we're going to hear about it. It might be like a quick preseason storyline, but after the playoffs start, national media is definitely not going to talk about it. I mean, obviously local media, that's all we have to talk about. So I'm sure WIP and the Fanatic are going to be fucking burying the Eagles for the next 2 months, 3 months until we get in the draft talk about how they tanked.
Oh, they'll beat it into a dead horse.
Oh yeah, absolutely. That's what we do. I don't think Doug needs to really survive anything though. He survived the past two press conferences, and that's all I think he needed to get through. I watched the press conference after the game just because I was curious to see what he was A, going to say, and B, how he looked.
Oh yeah,
he looked so uncomfortable. I felt so bad for him because, like, you could tell by his answers. Like, you could tell just by his answers, his oh yeah, it was my decision to do this. The fuck it wasn't. You know it wasn't your decision. Dude,
it's never been your decision.
It was absolutely not your decision to put Nate Sudfeld in. Come on. You've been the coach for 4 years with him, and you know what he's going to give you. You've seen it in the 2017 game against the Cowboys, week 17, and he does nothing. I think we scored 6 points. We lost 9-6 in that game. Stupid. Like, we know he's not going to do anything. We all know it.
And you knew it just by practice alone that you made Jalen Hurts the backup to Carson Wentz.
Yeah, Jalen Hurts is the backup ever since week two.
I know.
And Nate Sudfeld's been deactivated.
Yeah. So you knew what you were getting from him.
I'm over it. I'm just over Howie Roseman. It's all his fault. Which for me leads me into our newest segment, Scumbag of the Week.
Bum, bum, bum.
And I'm going to let you get started on your Scumbag of the Week, and then I'll go into mine because I need to to rest up for this one.
My scumbag of the week is Carson Wentz. I truly feel that he blew an opportunity to come out and speak to his fans, to tell the fans, I want to be here. I love this city. I love you. I want to appreciate you. I want to show you what I can do. Just give me the opportunity again. I want to stay in this city. And what does he do? He cowers. And he doesn't want to talk to the media. He goes to his home in Houston. Well, you know what? Fuck you, buddy. All right? I'm over here trying to tell you that I want you to be back as my starting quarterback. I don't want Jalen Hurts. I want you. But you're going to, no, I don't want to talk. Oh, yeah. Dude, you know what? Grow a set and come onto WIP or Fanatic, or just hold your own press conference while you're holding your little shotgun, getting ready to shoot some deer or whatever you want, and say, I want to stay in Philly. I'm going to do everything in my power to stay in Philly. That's my job. They're going to have to take that job away from me when I'm dead and gone. That's what I want. But no, you ran away like a little bitch.
So I disagree in the extent of I don't believe he needed to talk into at media availability, because he's going to have a bunch of fucking bunch of fucking people preying on him to ask so many ridiculous questions that he's going to answer the same way, the same how. Basically, I'm going in off season. I have to evaluate my situation. And that's basically what he's going to do. He's going to Houston to just go fucking chill out for a week or two. And then he's going to have a decision for whoever he's got to tell. I personally don't think he needs to tell anyone. If he wants to come back, be dedicated to the team, absolutely. If he wants to get traded, I mean, that's the fault of fucking our entire front office, because they handled them poorly. Which leads me into my scumbag of the week, Jeffrey Lurie. The biggest scumbag there is for keeping the man himself, Howie fucking Roseman, on his fucking staff for the past, 21 years, you said?
Yep.
Absolutely absurd. Howie Roseman can't do shit. So why do we still have him? And then it's got to be Jeffrey Lurie's decision to, you know, decide to want to run this thing back for whatever fucking stupid-ass reason. And he wants to run it back with maybe a different defensive coordinator, just because Jim Schwartz probably was like, I'm tired of the bullshit here anyway, so I want to leave. And you keep saying he was a scapegoat. I think Jim Schwartz was just like, fuck it, I'm out. I see how disastrous this whole thing is from ownership down. And it's really sad, because I used to be a big person, like a big supporter of Jeffrey Lurie. I love the way he ran the team. I love that he was, you know, in this decision-making in it, not to the point of Jerry Jones. He still lets his GM do things, but now I don't know what to think about him. I think he's turning into a fucking even worse version of Jerry Jones, because he's allowing his GM be his voice and do everything when his GM is completely incapable of doing it. So Jeffrey Lurie needs to absolutely just either sell the team at this point, or fucking grow a pair, like you said with Carson. He needs to fucking grow a pair and fire his GM. I don't care what kind of bullshit Howie Roseman has on him. I don't care if he cheated on his wife. Fucking get a divorce then. Like, I don't care. I don't care what he did. Just fire Howie Roseman, and then we could – I don't care if you have to fire Doug Peterson at the same time. Just Howie Roseman needs to be gone. Do the thing, Jeffrey Lurie. And then to your same proponent – he needs to come out and talk too. He needs to tell us, lay out a game plan, what he thinks this Philadelphia team and what direction he wants to take it in. Because 100%. Yeah, he could give the reins a little bit to Howie Roseman. Okay, the direction of the team's going this way. But I want to know how Jeffrey Lurie feels about the direction of the team. Yeah. I haven't heard shit from him.
Because you know, all the reports that came out, you brought back Jason Peters because he's best friends with Jeffrey Lurie. So, and you gave him more money in order to move from right guard to left tackle because he's best friends with Jeffrey Lurie. And you have like all these connections. Like Jeffrey Lurie is like friends with all these freaking players. Like, dude, you're an owner. All you have to do, show up to the games. You want to interact with your players? Fine. But you should have no connections. Like zero. Like a same way with a company. Like if you're a CEO, I think you should have really no connections.
I don't fully agree with that.
Do that for you.
I don't fully agree with that, because I think him having connections with, I don't think it should be so close to the point where you favor players, but well, him having connections.
That's what I mean.
With the players and, you know, being friends with them, or, you know, being close with them. I mean, that helps us get free agents because, you know, you have people saying, okay, Jeffrey Lurie is a good guy. He's a good person to come under, blah, blah, this, that, the other. But I don't necessarily agree with the way he's handled. I mean, it's the same thing with Howie. It's the reason why he's giving out the contracts that he did. He likes the players that he likes, and he doesn't. He didn't like Malcolm Jenkins enough to give him a contract. He doesn't like Zach Ertz enough to give him another contract. I saw something earlier on Twitter that, like, I kind of laughed about. All right, so Carson Wentz is 28. Zach Ertz is 30. We're treating them like they are 38. What? We're treating them like they're 38 and 40. Like they're on their last leg of their career. Like, they're not. Zach Ertz still has a shit ton in the tank, and Carson Wentz still has a shit ton in the tank.
I don't
understand why we can't build around them rather than building for them, like, or getting rid of them and rebuilding.
I think I completely disagree with Zach Ertz, man. I wanted them to trade him after last year. I didn't even want him to come back this year. And I personally think that he just gave up on the team this year. It really gave me a sour taste in my mouth because of him talking about the contract, and he didn't really do much this year. Like, he was basically
because the front office is the same thing like Malcolm Jenkins. I mean, Malcolm Jenkins played differently, but the front office didn't show him respect. And if you're not getting respect from the top down, then you're not going to work hard. It's just like management at your job. If your management tells you, okay, you know, I really don't think you're worth that raise, do you really think you're going to work harder?
Yeah, you're right. But he had 2 years left on his contract. I think he should have played this year at least to show that he deserved it. Again, like, I know he did it last year, but he's, in my eyes, he should have showed you're fighting for that contract. You can
listen there, this year. That preseason blowout with Howie Roseman had to have been something detrimental that made him really want to just be like, all right, I'm out. Because a person going into the last season of his contract should not be crying that it was, you know, that this was the last time that he's going to be in the city and playing for the city. Like, that is, he's still got a year under his contract, but yeah, he already has it indicated to him that he's getting traded. But yeah, Jeffrey Lurie's my scumbag of the week.
Makes sense. He definitely deserves to be there. That's for sure. But with, like, Zach Ertz, Jason Kelce and Carson Wentz all stayed after the game. They were there for like 2 hours on the field with the security guy, Dom. So everyone, they were on the bench just staring at everything. Like you said, like, Zach Ertz had a hell of a press conference. He talked about everything. Jason Kelce didn't. He hasn't talked either. And that's the person I want to hear from because of what he said like a couple weeks ago, maybe a month ago, that there's no reason to tank for a pick. And then all of a sudden, the team you're on tanks for a pick.
So, well, he's got too much respect for the organization to come out and talk now because of how passionate he is. If he came out and talked now, he would completely bash Doug Peterson. He completely bash the entire management. And he's just trying to be more classy and say, all right, he's going to take a step back from it. He first has to evaluate if he really wants to retire or not. Yeah. If he does, and I think that's why he hasn't talked, because when he talks to the media, he wants to have the answer of if he's staying or if he's going. So that's the way I feel. It's going to be really upsetting to see all three of them go, and on top of a couple other fan favorite Eagles. But that's the 2020 season. And
yeah, it's been a dumpster fire, and it just keeps getting it. Keeps going. So at least we'll have something to talk about all off season, though. Like, there's going to be nonstop moves. I feel it.
Yep.
All right. Well, that wraps up another great episode of the Jersey Bullies. You can follow me at Brezzo E on Twitter, or @Jersey_Bullies on Twitter. Interact with us. Tell us what you think about this episode. You want to yell at me for my Carson Wentz take? Bring it on. Let's go. But you want to yell at Tyler for his Jeffrey Lurie, which nobody's going to do that. But anyway, that's all I have.
Follow me at TFMoney11. Obviously, you can also contact me at the Jersey Bullies Twitter. Follow us all at BPP on Twitch for a lot of streaming stuff that we're going to be doing. It's not necessarily sports, but it's going to be a lot of fun gaming with everyone that's in the basement protocol.
All right. Thank you, guys. Have a great day.
Bye, Dad.